Good evening, everybody. Turn your hymnals to 120. 120. I heard an old, old story, how the Savior came from glory, how He gave His life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about His groaning, of His precious blood's atoning. Then I repented of my sins and won the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and He bought me with His redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew Him, and all my love is due Him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. I heard about His healing, of His cleansing power revealing, how He made the lame to walk again, and He caused the blind to see. And then I cried, dear Jesus, come and heal my broken spirit. And somehow Jesus came and brought to me the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and He bought me with His redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew Him, and all my love is due Him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. I heard about a mansion He has built for me in glory, and I heard about the streets of gold beyond the crystal sea, about the angels singing and the old redemption story. And some sweet day I'll sing up there the song of victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and He bought me with His redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew Him, and all my love is due Him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. Amen.
sinner, lost and left to die. Raise your head for love's passing by. Come to Jesus, come to Jesus, come to Jesus and live. Now your burden's lifted, buried far away. Precious blood is washed away the stain. So sing to Jesus, sing to Jesus, sing to Jesus and live. Like a newborn baby, don't be afraid to crawl. And remember when we walk, sometimes we fall. So follow Jesus, follow Jesus, follow Jesus and live. Sometimes the way is lonely, steep and filled with pain. So every sky is dark and pours the rain. Cry to Jesus, cry to Jesus, cry to Jesus and live. Music fills the night. When you can't contain your joy inside, dance for Jesus, dance for Jesus, dance for Jesus and live. With your final heartbeat, kiss the world goodbye, and go in peace and laugh on glory's side. And fly to Jesus, fly to Jesus, fly to Jesus.
With a broken heart.
him. God wanted me. Now most of us, I dare to say, we've got an Isaac standing in God's way. But it's on this altar you two must prove that it's not wasn't him. God wanted me. And on this altar where he lay, just to find it wasn't him, God wanted me. Jesus, I surrender all to him. I freely give, and I will ever love, and I'll trust him in his presence daily live. It wasn't him, God wanted me. And on this altar where he lay, just to find it wasn't him, God wanted me.
Prisoner, me son, stop fighting.
You set me free, so I'll shake off these heavy chains and wipe away every stain. No, I'm not who I used to be, 'cause I am redeemed. Oh, 'cause all my life I have been called unworthy. Named by the choice of my shame and regret. Child, lift up your head. I remember, oh God, you're not done with me yet. 'Cause I am redeemed. You set me free. So I'll shake off these heavy chains and wipe away every stain. No, because I don't have to be the old man inside of me, 'cause his day is long dead and gone. Because I've got a new name, a new life, I'm not the same, and a hope that will carry me home, 'cause I am redeemed. You set me free. So I'll wipe away heavy chains and wipe away every stain. No, I'm not who I used to be, 'cause I am redeemed. You set me free. So I'll shake off these heavy chains and wipe away every stain. No, I'm not who I. I am redeemed. Oh, well, thank God, redeemed.
There's a line in this song, it's an old song, one that we do quite often, that says, "The wheels of mortal life shall all stand still." Yep. And I can't help but think when I hear that part of that song, I think of that big hamster wheel that probably you and I both feel like we're on all the time. We're going and going. Life takes us and we're rushing and rushing. And we're not getting anywhere, so we think we'll go faster. So we go faster and faster, still not getting anywhere. Yet the next line of that song says, "The wheels of mortal life shall all stand still." We need to remember to stand still before the Lord and let Him speak to us. There waits for me a glad tomorrow, where gates of pearl swing open wide. And when I pass this veil of sorrow, I'll dwell upon the other side. Someday, beyond the reach of mortal kin, someday, God only knows just where and when, the wheels of mortal life shall all stand still. And I shall go to dwell on Zion's hill. Someday I'll hear. beyond the shadows of the tomb, and all the bells of heaven ringing, while saints are singing home sweet home. Someday, beyond the reach of mortal kin, someday, God only knows just where and when, the wheels of mortal life shall all stand still, and I shall go to dwell on Zion's hill. Someday my labors will be ended.
Yes, sir.
And all my wanderings will be o'er, and all earth's broken ties be mended, and I shall sigh and weep no more. Someday, beyond the reach of mortal kin, someday, God only knows just where and when, the wheels of mortal life shall all stand still, and I shall go to dwell on Zion's hill. Someday, beyond the reach of mortal kin, someday, God only knows just where and when, the wheels of mortal life shall all stand still, and I shall go to dwell on Zion's hill.
I don't have enough of that yet.
Someday, beyond the reach of mortal kin, someday, God only knows just where and when, the wheels of mortal life shall all stand still, and I shall go to dwell on Zion's hill.
Have we enjoyed this good singing tonight? You know, we're so thankful for the talent that we have here, don't we? And we just don't even realize that we're too spoiled. We are too spoiled, and we are just so thankful for the singing, thankful for the preaching that we hear every week, and it's a blessing. We just thank the Lord for it. All right, we're going to go ahead and turn Trevor Thompson loose. Let's go ahead and make him feel welcome.
You guys decided to give me more than 5 minutes this time, I see. No, I'm just kidding with you. I would prefer it much better the other way, but they told me they was going to vote me in as pastor last time, but I'd hate to see what happened if it happened twice. But no, it's... always Doug coming up with something. You know, it's a new start to a new year, and I sit back there and a big tear streamed down my face, but at the same time, I chuckled. I have absolutely given up on New Year's resolutions. I've given up on them.
For the past 5 years, I've tried to lose 30 pounds every year. And still to this day, if James Ray was here, he would still poke me in the belly with that cane every time I walked through the door. And I thought, man, that guy just absolutely aggravated the tar out of me. And there was sometimes I went home and I thought, man, if he pokes me in the belly one more time with that cane, I'm going to say something to him. But I miss that old guy. I miss him. I miss him a lot. I miss a lot of the ones that, as I stand up here tonight, they're not here any longer. But tonight I'd like to honor James Ray a little bit by reading a whole chapter of the Bible. And then we'll go back through and we'll break it down. And it's very simple what I want to get across to you tonight. We're going to be in Nehemiah chapter 4 tonight. But what I want you to understand is the people that we see in the chapter 4 of Nehemiah, and really throughout the whole book of Nehemiah, they were people that was longing for the move of God in their life. They was longing to see something happen. They seen adversary come in troubles and trials. They faced all kinds of different things. But overall, they was concerned with the plan that God had for their life. And tonight, I'd like to talk just a little bit about that. Nehemiah chapter 4, it says, "But it came to pass that when Sanballat heard that they builded the wall, he was wroth, and it took great indignation, and mocked the Jews, and he spake before his brethren and his army of Samaria, and he said, What do these feeble Jews? Will they fortify themselves? Will they sacrifice? Will they make an end in the day? Will they receive the stones out of the heaps of the rubbish which are burned?" Now Tobiah the Ammonite was by him, and he said, "Even that which they build, if a fox go up, he shall even break down their stone wall. Hear, O God, for we are despised, and turn the reproach upon their own head, and give them for a prey in the land of captivity, and cover not their iniquity, and let not their sin be blotted out from before thee, for they have provoked thee to anger before the builders. So built we the wall, and all the wall was joined together unto half thereof, and the people had a mind to work. But it came to pass that when Sanballat and Tobiah and the Arabs and the Ammonites and the Ashdodites heard the walls of Jerusalem were made up and that the breaches began to be stopped, then they were very wroth and conspired all of them together to come and fight against Jerusalem and to hinder it. Nevertheless, we made our prayer unto God, and we set watch against them day and night because of them. And Judah said, The strength of the bearers and burdens is decayed, and there is much rubbish, so that we are not able to build the wall. And our adversary said, They shall not know, neither see, till we come in the midst of them, and we slay them, and cause the work to cease. And it came to pass that when the Jews that were dealt by them came, they said unto us 10 times, From all places whence ye shall return unto they will be upon you. Therefore set I in the lower places behind the wall, and on the higher places I even set the people after their families with their swords, their spears, and their bows. And I look, and I rose up and said to the nobles and the rulers and the rest of the people, Be not ye afraid of them. Remember the Lord, which is great and terrible, and fight for your brethren and your sons and your daughters and your wives and your houses. And it came to pass when our enemies heard that it was known unto us, and God had brought their counsel to naught, that we returned all of us to the wall. everyone into his own work. And it came to pass that the time forth that the half of my servants wrought in work, and the other half of them held both their spears, their shields, and their bows, and the Habergeans, and the rulers were behind all the house of Judah. They which built the wall, and they bear burdens, and they laid it, every one with one of his hands wrought in the work, and with the other hand held a weapon. For the builders, everyone had his sword girded by his side, and so builded. And he that sounded the trumpet was by me, and he said unto the nobles, and to all the rulers, and to the rest of the people, the work is great and large, and we are separated upon the wall, one far from another. In that place, in what place, therefore, ye hear the sound of the trumpet, resort ye thither unto us, our God shall fight for us. So we labored in the work, and the half of them held the spears from the rising of the morning till the stars appeared. Likewise, at the same time, said I unto the people, let everyone with his servant lodge within Jerusalem, that in the night they may guard, be a guard unto us, and labor on the day. So neither I nor my brethren, nor the servants, nor the men of guard which followed me, none of us put off our clothes, saving that every one of them put off her washing. I had to do that for James Ray. I know that's a lot, but I'm going to break it down for you here real, real fast. I'm going to get you out of here. All you got to do is say a lot of amens. Are you ready? Okay. So I need you to understand something. These people had came back to the city of Jerusalem under the leadership of Nehemiah. And they had came back under one circumstance, and that was to rebuild the wall of Jerusalem. Now, here's what you got to understand. This wall of Jerusalem, it wasn't just any wall. It was a wall that represented God. It represented the security. It represented the peace. It represented the protection. It represented everything of God to them. And here they have came back. However, what we see is as soon as they get started, guess what there is? There's critics. There's people saying, you can't do it. You're not smart enough. You ain't got the manpower. You're not capable of it. Can I tell you something tonight? That each and every time that you go to do something for God, there will be a naysayer in your life. There will be somebody that steps up and says, you're not capable of doing it. But can I remind you of something? Way back in Nehemiah chapter 1, Nehemiah went to the king and he said something very specific. He said, God has led me to go back to Jerusalem and to build the wall. Let me tell you what's significant about that. When God lays something on your heart, when God leads you to do something, if God is in it, there's not a thing out there that can stop you. I told Xander tonight, actually, I got to give you the whole story. Megan said, we're going to Mamaw and Papaw's church. Daddy's preaching. He said, Daddy's preaching is boring. I said, well, fine. You preach. He said, I can't preach. I won't even read. But you know what I think's funny about that? I've seen a lot of men back in the day that couldn't read a lick of scripture. But they had a love for God, and they would just preach the house down. I'm here to tell you that it's not about what your qualities are. It's not about what your capabilities are. It's about you following the will of God in your life. That's what it's about. So we see that they go and they start to build the wall. And the first thing, as soon as Nehemiah, he feels the critics, he feels everything, he feels it, the first thing he does is he runs to God. He runs to God. Just like I preached last time, if you could do anything in life, if I could give you any advice, especially you young people, it's when you face troubles and trials, run to God. He ran to God. And he prayed a prayer. Now, I'm telling you, if you read the prayer, it's absolutely like, wow. He says, God, don't blot out their sins. God, let them fall upon their head. It makes me feel a whole lot better about some of the prayers I've prayed in life. But here's what you have to understand. Nehemiah was upset. He was not upset at them because they were coming against him. He was upset at them because they was coming against his God. They were coming against his God. So he runs and he prays. And then after we see he prays, he tells them, he says, okay, now we're going to set a watch. Because at this point in time, it was past talk. It was past the fact that they were just trying to discourage them. Now all of a sudden, they're saying, if you continue, we'll tear it back down. We'll tear it back down. Struck fear into them. But can I tell you something? They set watch. He prayed to God and he set, then he told him, he said, set a watch. Can I be honest with you as a human being for just a second? I'm sick and tired of people just saying, I'm leaving it up to God. I'm leaving it up to God. There's people that's leaving stuff up to God. However, they're not setting a watch. Can I tell you something? You can leave it up to God, but if you ain't controlling what's going in and out of your house, you're letting the devil straight in. There's nothing that God can do if you're not willing to set a watch over your own family. They set a watch. They knew that there was an enemy on the outside. They knew they was there. Nehemiah told him. He said, stand guard. Stand guard. But you got to understand, these are the same people that destroyed them once. Can I tell you about something that's already destroyed you? It strikes fear into your heart. And Nehemiah saw that. He was a great leader and he saw that. He saw that fear. But he encouraged him. Listen how he encouraged him. He said, don't fear. Why? Because the Lord God is on your side. Don't fear. And then he encourages what should encourage every man in here. He said, stand still and don't be afraid. But then he reminds them what they're fighting for. He said, fight for your brothers, your sons, your daughters, your wives, and your house. Can I tell you something? Nehemiah was looking for men that were willing to step up. Men that was willing to lay their life down for the cause of God's divine plan. I want to ask you something tonight. Do we have any men in here that's willing to step up, fight for your families, fight for your sons, fight for your daughters, fight for your homes, fight for your church, fight for your freedoms, fight for your God? Is there anybody willing to step up? And so, we see that after he tells them that, there's something that ever since I came to this church at the very first, back when Mark Bear looked me in the eye and he said, if you ever take this girl out of Beach Fork, I will beat you. No, he didn't say that. I felt like he said that. So you know what I did? I waited until he left and then I left too. But listen to this. Listen. Okay. Fight for your sons and daughters. But there's been something that's happened to Beach Fork, and it's happening in every church across America, and we don't realize. You see, there was guys and there was men that have been fighting for so long. And here's what Judah said to Nehemiah. He said, Nehemiah, some of our laborers are decayed. They're old. They're tired. They can't fight anymore. For a long time in this church, I've heard about passing the mantle. Passing the mantle. Passing the mantle. Passing the mantle. My question to you is, has somebody picked it up? Has somebody picked it up? Passing the mantle. So he tells him, he says, listen, he said, some of our laborers are decaying. So they had laborers working, and then they have people fighting. Well, when the laborers are all of a sudden decaying and not there for laboring, guess what they had to do? The Bible says that they held a tool in one hand and they held a weapon in the other. Both sides. Can I tell you something? I appreciate every one of you because I believe that most of you in here fight for your family. But can I tell you something? It's not okay just to fight for your family. We can't forget why God put us on this earth. You see, these guys were sent to build a wall. But now they're having to fight. But Nehemiah tells them, it's okay to defend. It's okay to fight. But we can't forget about the wall. Let me tell you something. It's okay to realize that your family needs saving. But it's not right to forget about a lost and dying world that needs to hear about Jesus. We can protect our family all we want, but we got to still be building the kingdom of God. We got to still be building the kingdom of God. So they continue the work. They continue. They continue the work. Nehemiah tells him, he says, listen, we're few now. There's not a ton of us. So they is all spread out. He said, I'm going to carry the man carrying the trumpet next to me. And if you hear the trumpet blow, you run to the battle. You run to the battle. But then listen what he says. He says, you run to the battle and the Lord will fight for you. The Lord will fight for you. I am a firm believer that God wants to work on some people's behalf. He's not looking for somebody that's qualified. He's not looking for somebody that's got a PhD. He's not looking for somebody that's all strength and all powerful. He's just looking for a willing vessel that's is willing to be used by Him. Be used by Him. You see, these were men of God. They wasn't looking for God to do everything for them. They wasn't looking for the easy road. They were men of God that was looking to be used by God. I got one question for you tonight. One. Is there anybody in here that's willing to be used for the cause of Christ? That's willing to lay down your life? I can't answer for you. You got to answer that in your own heart. Is there anybody in here that's willing to lay down their life, to go to the front lines, that's willing to work and to fight for their family? Is there any? If that's you tonight, I got some really good news. You see, everybody that's included in Nehemiah, they were looking to be used by God. However, a couple books back, I need to remind you of something. Back in 2 Chronicles 16 and 9, listen to this. Listen to this. The eyes of the Lord run to and fro throughout the earth to show himself strong on the behalf of them whose heart is perfect to God. Can I tell you something that is more encouraging than anything that I've ever heard in my life? There are men in here that are looking to be used by lay down everything for the cause of Christ. But can I tell you something that's very, very, very special to my heart tonight? It just encourages me beyond what anybody could say. God is also looking for you. You are looking for God, but I want you to understand tonight that God is looking for you. Beach Fork, I got word for you. I've watched for a long time now men that were willing to step up and to fight, standing in the gap for one another. I can think about so many special messages as Mark was up here talking. I'll tell you what was running through my mind. Take the candy. Take the candy. Anybody remember Take the Candy? Take the candy. I'll never forget it, Mark, wherever you're at. I'll never forget Take the Candy. I'll be honest, I thought about those strawberry things that they hand out at the door. I hate them things. Hate them. And it seems like I ended up with 10 or 15 of them, and I would aggravate people to death because I'd dump out my pockets into some lady's purse. It didn't matter who it was. I was getting rid of every one of them. And it seemed like the more I'd look at and say, I don't want any. No, you need to take a few. Take the candy. Take the candy. But for a long time, there's been men in here that's been willing to step up for the cause of Christ. In Nehemiah 4, we see that the wall was halfway built. Beachwork, I believe that we're way farther than halfway. But we're not home yet. And we can't stop. I'll tell you, Beachwork, you guys are a place that is tighter than any church I've ever been in my life. And if you ever read Nehemiah chapter 3, I was thinking about this as I was reading. It's a really boring chapter. It really is. Because here's all it is. It is so-and-so worked on this part of the wall. And next to him was so-and-so. And he worked on this gate. Next to him was so-and-so. And he worked on this gate. Next to him was so-and-so. And they worked on this part of the wall. Beachwork, can I tell you tonight, if I can give you any encouragement tonight, it's band together with one another, hold each other's hand, and work one mind, one accord for the cause of Christ. And don't get discouraged because you're not working on the same thing that somebody else is not working on. Because everyone in here, even my father-in-law, believe it or not, has a purpose. I got Luke to laugh. But everybody in here, you got a purpose in this church. You got a purpose with God. And if you're willing to be used by God, God is willing to use you. Amen. Scotty, if you want to come give us a song. Puckett, you want to come play something? Tonight I'd like to open up these altars. I got one New Year's resolution this year. Well, really two. Not gain any more weight. And the second is to be a whole lot closer to Christ when 24 runs around. That's something I feel that should be in each and every one of our hearts. That we should be searching out Christ. What can we do? If you're sitting in here tonight and the only thing that you do is come to this church, sit down like a sponge and soak up all the good singing and good preaching, can I tell you something? Get busy. Get busy. Because there's plenty to do in the kingdom of God. There's plenty. The altars are open if you'd all be standing, as Scotty says.
Have thine own way, Lord. Have thine own way. the potter, I am the clay. Mold me and make me after thy will. While I am waiting, yielded and still, have thine own way. Search me and try me, Master, today. Whiter than snow.